दिस इज द स्टोरी कर्मा बाय खुशवंत सिंह. सर मोहनलाल लुक्ड एट हिमसेल्फ इन द मिरर ऑफ अ फर्स्ट क्लास वेटिंग रूम एट द रेलवे स्टेशन. द मिरर वॉज ऑब्वियसली मेड इन इंडिया. द रेड ऑक्साइड एट इट्स बैक हैड कम ऑफ एट सेवरल प्लेसेस एंड लॉन्ग लाइन्स ऑफ ट्रांसल्यूसेंट ग्लास कट अक्रॉस इट्स सर्फेस. सो मोहन स्माइल एट द मिरर विथ एन एयर ऑफ पिटी एंड पैट्रोनेज. You are so very much like everything else in this country. Inefficient, dirty, indifferent, he murmured. The mirror smiled back at Sir Mohan. You are a bit of all right, old chap, it said. Distinguished, efficient, even handsome. That neatly trimmed mustache, the suit from Savile Row with the carnation in the buttonhole, the aroma of eau de cologne, talcum powder and scented soap all about you. Yes, old fellow, you are a bit of all right. Sir Mohan threw out his chest, smoothed his balliol tie for the umpteenth time and waved a goodbye to the mirror. He glanced at his watch. There was still time for a quick one. Koi hai. A bearer in white livery appeared through a wire gauge door. Ek chota, ordered Sir Mohan. And sank into a large cane chair to drink and ruminate. Outside the waiting room, Sir Mohanlal's luggage lay piled along the wall. On a small grey steel trunk, Lakshmi, Lady Mohanlal sat chewing a betel leaf and fanning herself with her newspaper. She was a short and fat and in her middle 40s. She wore a dirty white sari with a red border. On one side of her nose glistened a diamond nose ring, and she had several gold bangles on her arms. She had been talking to the bearer until Sir Mohan had summoned him inside. As soon as he had gone, she hailed a passing railway coolie. Where does the Jinana stop? Right at the end of the platform. The coolie flattened his turban to make a cushion, hoisted the steel trunk on his head, and moved down the platform. Lady Lal picked up her brass stiffened carrier and ambled along behind him. On the way, she stopped by a hawker stall to replenish her silver betel leaf case and then joined the coolie. She sat down on her steel trunk, which the coolie had put down, and started talking to him. Are the trains very crowded on these lines? These days, all trains are crowded, but you'll find room in the Jinana. Then I might as well get over the bother of eating. Lady Lal opened the brass carrier and took out a bundle of crammed chapatis and some mango pickle. While she ate, the coolie sat opposite her on his hunches, drawing lines in the gravel with his finger. Are you traveling alone, sister? No, I am with my master brother. He is in the waiting room. He travels first class. He is a vizier and a barrister and meets so many officers and Englishmen in the trains, and I am only a native woman. I can't understand English and don't know their ways, so I keep to my Jinana inter class. Lakshmi chatted away merrily. She was fond of a little gossip and had no one to talk to at home. Her husband never had any time to spare for her. She lived in the upper story of the house, and he on the ground floor. He did not like her poor illiterate relatives hanging about his bungalow, so they never came. He came up to her once in a while at night and stayed for a few minutes. He just ordered her about in anglicized Hindustani, and she obeyed passively. These nocturnal visits had, however, borne no fruit. The signal came down and the clanging of the bell announced the approaching train. Lady Lal hurriedly finished off her meal. She got up, still licking the stone of the pickled mango. She emitted a long, loud belch as she went to the public tap to rinse her mouth and wash her hands. After washing, she dried her mouth and hands with the loose end of her sari and walked back to her steel trunk, belching and thanking the gods for the favor of her filling meal. The train steamed in. Lakshmi found herself facing an almost empty inter-class Jinana compartment next to the guard's van. At the tail end of the train, The rest of the train was packed. She heaved her squat, bulky frame through the door and found a seat by the window. She produced a 2-anna bit from a knot in her sari and dismissed the coolie. She then opened her betel case and made herself 2 betel leaves charged with a red and white paste, minced betel nuts and cardamoms. These she thrust into her mouth till her cheeks bulged on both sides. Then she rested her chin on her hands and sat gazing idly at the jostling crowd on the platform. The arrival of the train didn't disturb Sir Mohanlal's sang-froid. He continued to sip his scotch and ordered the bearer to tell him when he had moved to the luggage to the first class compartment. Excitement, bustle and hurry were exhibitions of bad breathing. And Sir Mohan was eminently well-bred. He wanted everything tickety-boo and orderly. In his 5 years abroad, Sir Mohan had acquired the manners and attitudes of the upper classes. He rarely spoke Hindustani. When he did, it was like an Englishman's, only the very necessary words and properly anglicized. But he fancied his English finished and refined at no less a place than the University of Oxford. He was fond of conversation, and like a cultured Englishman, he could talk on almost any subject, books, politics, people. How frequently had he heard English people say that he spoke like an Englishman? Sir Mohan wondered if he would be traveling alone. It was a cantonment and some English officers might be on the train. His heart warmed at the prospect of an impressive conversation. He never showed any sign of eagerness to talk to the English as most Indians did, nor was he loud, aggressive and opinionated like them. He went about his business with an expressionless matter-of-factness. He would retire to his corner by the window and get out a copy of the Times. He would fold it in a way in which the name of the paper was visible to others while he did the crossword puzzle. The Times always attracted attention. Someone would like to borrow it when he put it aside with a gesture signifying, "I've finished with it." Perhaps someone would recognize his Balliol tie, which he always wore while traveling. That would open a vista leading to a fairy tale of Oxford colleges, masters, dons, tutors, boat races, and rugger matches. If both the Times and the tie failed, Sir Mohan would koi hai his bearer to get the scotch out. Whiskey never failed with Englishmen. Then followed Sir Mohan's handsome gold cigarette case filled with English cigarettes. English cigarettes in India, how on earth did he get them? Sure he didn't mind. And Sir Mohan's understanding smile. Of course he didn't. But could he use the Englishman as a medium to commune with his dear old England? Those 5 years of grey backs and gowns, of sports blazers and mixed doubles, of dinners at the inns of court and nights with Piccadilly prostitutes. 5 years of a crowded, glorious life, worth far more than the 45 in India, with his dirty, vulgar countrymen, with sordid details of the road to success, of nocturnal visits to the upper story, and all too brief sexual acts with obvious old Lakshmi, smelling of sweat and raw onions. Sir Mohan's thoughts were disturbed by the bearer announcing the installation of the Sahib's luggage in a first-class coupe next to the engine. Sir Mohan walked to his coupe with a studied gait. He was dismayed. The compartment was empty. With a sigh, he sat down in a corner and opened the copy of the Times he had read several times before. Sir Mohan looked out of the window down the crowded platform. His face lit up as he saw two English soldiers trudging along, looking in all the compartments for room. They had their haversacks slung behind their backs and walked unsteadily. Sir Mohan decided to welcome them. Even though they were entitled to travel only second class, he would speak to the guard. One of the soldiers came up to the last compartment and stuck his face through the window. He surveyed the compartment and noticed the unoccupied berth. "Bill," he shouted. "One." His companion came up, also looked in and looked at Sir Mohan. "Get the nigger out," he muttered to his companion. They opened the door and turned to the half-smiling, half-protesting Sir Mohan. "Reserved," yelled Bill. "Janta reserved. Army Fauji," exclaimed Jim, pointing to his khaki shirt. "Ekdam jao, get out." I say, surely," protested Sir Mohan in his Oxford accent. The soldiers paused. It almost sounded like English, but they knew better than to trust their inebriated ears. The engine whistled and the guard waved his green flag. They picked up Sir Mohan's suitcase and flung it onto the platform, then followed his thermos flask, suitcase, bedding and the Times. Sir Mohan was livid with rage. "Preposterous, preposterous," he shouted, hoarse with anger. "I'll have you arrested. Guard, guard." Will and Jim paused again. It did sound like English, but it was too much of the kinks for them. "Keep your ruddy mouth shut," and Jim struck Sir Mohan flat on the face. The engine gave another short whistle and the train began to move. The soldiers caught Sir Mohan by the arms and flung him out of the train. He reeled backwards, tripped on his bedding and landed on the suitcase. Toodle-doo. Sir Mohan's feet were glued to the earth and he lost his speech. He stared at the lighted window of the train going past him in quickening tempo. The tail end of the train appeared with a red light and the guard standing in the open doorway with the flags in his hands. In the interclass Janana compartment was Lakshmi, fair and fat, on whose nose the diamond nose ring glistened against the station lights. Her mouth was bloated with betel saliva, which she had been storing up to spit as soon as the train had cleared the station. As the train sped past the lighted part of the platform, Lady Lal spat and sent a jet of red dribble flying across like a dart.
Thank you for attending this session. Do share and subscribe to this channel for more lessons like this. Check out other video lessons by clicking on the video.